Here you can see my name and my email address, and you can then, if you have any follow-up questions, you can contact me by email to ask questions. So I think this is a quite interesting topic. We consider magnetic monopole as an elementary particle. It is a very interesting
question.
Could you
make a full screen?
Ah, should I try? Okay.
Thank you.
So I think it's a very interesting topic if we consider magnetic monopole as elementary particle to try to calculate its mass. And in my presentation, I will show that, in fact, it is possible to calculate it. And here are the ingredients I will use. Firstly, I will use analysis of Mikhailov magnetic charge measurements. And here you can see the references of which publications this is described in. Second, I will use Keith Frederick's magnetic monopole track measurements. This is not peer-reviewed. He only published a preprint, but in any case, his measurements are documented in this. And I will use the theory that is in the book, which I am editing, called Maxwell-Dirac theory and Occam's razor. Here we develop electron theory, and our electron theory also applies to magnetic monopole. And what I present, in fact, will be a new chapter in the second edition of our book. So comments will be very welcome. This is one of my main motivation to present here, to get feedback and comments, so to make sure that we have everything all right for our second edition. I would like to say big thank you to George Eagley for bringing attention to Mikhailov's work, which I did not know about before. Okay, let's see how I can move next. Yes, so here is the history of magnetic monopole theory. As most of you know, Dirac and Schwinger used theoretic ideas to estimate what should be the charge of the magnetic monopole. And this is the ratio they estimated between the magnetic monopole charge and the electron charge. So G is, stands for magnetic charge, and E stands for the electron charge. And the subscript D and S are used to distinguish between the Dirac's estimation and Schwinger's estimation. It's only a factor of two difference. Now, theoretical physicists were thinking that these charge values somehow explain the quantum mechanical quantization of electric charge. But to this day, officially, theorists consider that these relationships are not experimentally confirmed. Okay, let's see what experiments actually say. Now, if you look in the history of magnetic monopole charge measurements, the first attempt was made by Austrian physicist Ehrenhaft in the 1930s to 1950s. He was active. And here you can see value of the magnetic charge that he measured. So he estimated on the order of magnitude to be 5 × 10⁻³⁰ joules square centimeter. Now the only person, as far as I know in the literature, attempted and successfully replicated and refined Ehrenhaft's measurements was Mikhailov's group. They were active in the 1980s and 1990s. And here you can see the precise value that they measured as the magnetic charge, elementary magnetic charge value. So this is 5.84 × 10⁻³ Gauss square centimeter. This figure illustrates the method of how they measured it. This is very similar method for both Ehrenhoff and Mikhailov. They used metallic nanoparticles. They used different ferromagnetic metals, and they were shining intense light on these nanoparticles. And here what you can see is the falling track of a nanoparticle, and the intense light shining on it in some cases created a magnetic charge on it. And this was detected by periodically switching magnetic field polarity. So here you can see that magnetic field is horizontal, and it is periodically switching from plus to minus direction. So as this nanoparticle is falling according to gravity, it is periodically making this zigzag movement as the magnetic field is accelerating it in some direction. And the reason why it's white is because they were shining intense light on it, and that's why the track appears white. So they made thousands of these kind of photographs, and they measured the magnetic charge value from the now, okay, what is the relationship between the value they measured and the Dirac's and Schwinger's estimation? Here you can see that the actual experimental value is approximately alpha squared over 3 times the Dirac monopole charge, or alpha squared over 6 the Schwinger monopole charge. Alpha is the electromagnetic fine structure constant. Now this is very surprising because this is not a small difference, but this is many orders of magnitude different than what theorists estimated. Now in the time of Ehrenhoff, the community of physicists was still much smaller. So actually other physicists knew about Ehrenhoff's work, but they just could not believe it. So they disregarded it. And I don't know if anybody knows about Mikhailov's work, because he published only in a very few places, as I outlined. So I think that most physicists probably don't even know about Mikhailov's replication. And so this is the status today, that we have this very interesting experimental result, which is in total conflict with the theory estimation. Now here you can see the statistics of Mikhailov's experiments. So in this chart, you can see how many samples they measured with different magnetic charge values. And the unit one here corresponds to this 5.84 times 10 to the minus 3 Gauss square centimeter elementary magnetic charge. So you see that most of nanoparticles had only one unit of charge, but they had 2, 3, 4 and so forth number of these elementary charges. And it is very clearly seen how this is quantized. So this is really some kind of an elementary charge value. Okay, is it clear so far what Mikhailov's measured? All right, let's continue. Now at this point, we have to look a little bit about the concept of Zitterbewegung. And in our book, this is a very important concept for understanding what the electron is and what the electron structure is. So what we do in our book, we build the electron's Zitterbewegung model. And I know that there are in the history of physics many different electron models. Maybe some people are tired of all these models. In our case, the special idea of our electron model is that we did not want to make any hypothesis. We did not want to hypothesize that electron is like this or that. What we are interested in is to solve Maxwell's equations. So we aim in the book to derive electron properties from Maxwell equation. And in the end, what we realize is the elementary particle mass is the energy of its electromagnetic field. So we really can understand what the electron is made of. Electron is made of its electromagnetic field, and the field energy gives the mass. And it's the same for any elementary particle. Now, in particular, electron is not a point particle, but it has this iter bewegung motion. And in the rest frame, the radius of its charge is iter bewegung oscillation is the reduced Compton radius. At the first day of the conference, there was somebody raised the question, what is the reduced Compton radius? But in our view, it is the radius of the iter bewegung motion in the rest frame. Now, as the electron moves faster and faster, as you can see here, its faster movement shrinks down its iter bewegung radius. And in natural units, what we find is that the relativistic particle mass is inverse proportional to the iter bewegung radius. But what is important takeaway here is that to find the rest mass, we have to look at the largest possible iter bewegung radius, and the largest possible iter bewegung radius defines the particle mass. Okay, let's get back now to the relationship between charge value and mass. So again, in natural units, the Schwinger's ratio between the magnetic and electric charge is 1/alpha. And this simply implies that the magnetic monopole has alpha minus 2 times higher electromagnetic energy than the electron, if we assume the same charge radius. Now, we don't know what is the charge radius, but for now, let's assume a magnetic monopole and electron has the same. Then this Schwinger monopole is really a heavy particle. So in fact, theorists expect magnetic monopoles to be a very heavy particle. Okay, however, the actual charge quantum is alpha square over 6 times smaller. So it means that the actual monopole mass would be alpha square over 36 times the electron mass at the same charge radius. So basically, the mass is proportional to the square of the charge. So we square this value, multiply by alpha minus 2, and that's how we get the alpha square over 36. So at the same charge radius, our magnetic monopole is now a very light particle, in fact, much lighter than the electron. And this is what we expect, because in the experiments that produced magnetic monopole, physicists were shining light on the metallic nanoparticles, and the monopole was just created by the action of light. So because monopole is created by light, it cannot be a very heavy particle. So that's what we would want to see. Okay, so this 36 alpha minus 2 is the ratio that is multiplying the iter bewegung radius. So the, as you can see here, there is inverse relationship between mass and iter bewegung radius. So a light particle has a much larger iter bewegung radius than the electron. So the electron's iter bewegung radius is 0.386 picometers. And if we multiply it by 36 alpha minus 2, then we get 261 microns as iter bewegung radius. So again, this is assuming that the electron and monopole has the same charge radius. Okay, so the point here is that we now have some kind of an idea how to relate particle mass and particle charge value. Now, we don't know, of course, if the monopole charge radius is the same as the electron. And we can check now what the experiments actually say to see what the real values are. The first claim of detecting magnetic monopole zither bewegung was made a few years ago in this article authored by Skvortsov. It has a very strange title. It talks about exotic quasi-particles, but in the contents, they make it clear that they in fact produce magnetic monopoles, and they prove that their particles is magnetic monopole. So here, this is a track in a CR39 detector that they detect. You can see from the left, there is a so-called strange track. And then at this point, this something happens and they record this zither bewegung type motion. So this is from a sideways view. So this from sideways, if you look at the spiraling motion, you get this zigzag. There is of course an open question. If the monopole is a very light particle, how can a light particle leave such a track? This is something one would not expect, because a light particle should not be able to interact in such a way continuously. Or maybe there are many monopoles which just follow the same track. We don't know. We don't know, but in any case, we see zither bewegung with a very large radius, in this case, 100 microns, about 100 microns. So in fact, because of this, Skvortsov and his co-authors also proposed that the magnetic monopole has a very, very light mass, but they could not exactly calculate it. Now here we see the zither bewegung going sideways. Now, what if we have a detector surface and the zither bewegung goes perpendicular to our detector surface? So going back to the previous slide, when it goes perpendicular, you would see it as a circle, or in fact, an arc of a circle as it just partly goes through the detector surface. So this is what Fredericks has been measuring. So in fact, you can see here this photo from Fredericks' measurements. There is a strange track here, and there is an arc of a circle. And in my proposition, this arc of a circle is the zither bewegung motion, and we can see it only as long as it overlaps with the detector. So in the case of Fredericks, he also had intense light bursts to produce these monopoles, and he had a photographic emulsion film. So this is a picture developed in a photographic emulsion. Now, if we have zither bewegung perpendicular, it's an arc circle, but it can go to any direction. So if it goes somehow in a tilted angle, then in fact, what you detect from zither bewegung is this arc ellipse, right? And in fact, Fredericks was looking for this kind of arc ellipse patterns, and he was measuring the distribution of these arc ellipse patterns. So fortunately, Fredericks also made many, many photos, and he got some kind of statistics from it. He made thousands of photos, and he got around 15, 20 of these arc ellipses. And here you can see a photograph of a typical arc ellipse, which I interpret as the zither bewegung going somehow in a tilted angle. In his write-up, Fredericks has a very strange and complicated theory, and I do not agree with his interpretation. I think it's very strange. I think the simple explanation is that these are zither bewegung tracks that he has been measuring. Now, as you can see here, the interesting thing is that the highest value is about 4,000 microns, 4 millimeters. Let's look in more detail to his measurements. So this is a data table on the right of his measured values. And this A is the large semi-axis, and the B is the small semi-axis of the ellipse that you can see here. And The good news is that this 4.08 millimeter, it shows up even four times, but there is no higher value. So I think this is quite good that we can make the assumption that this is in fact the limiting number. And you can see that there is different B axis values because of the different angles. So this is good news. We have the limiting number, and this limiting number then corresponds to the Zitterbewegung radius in the rest frame. So we can conclude from Frederick's measurements that the magnetic monopole in the approximate rest frame has 4.08 millimeter Zitterbewegung radius. This is a very large value. And in fact, this is larger than the 36 alpha minus 2 we were thinking of before. This is 15.6 times larger than this value we previously thought. So because we got the 36 alpha minus 2 scaling by assuming that the monopole has same charge radius as the electron, this 15.6 times scaling tells us that its energy is even 15.6 times less, which means that its charge radius is larger, because the larger the particle's charge radius, the smaller its total electromagnetic energy is. So we can calculate in this way the charge radius of the magnetic monopole is 15.6 times 2.82 femtometers. 2.82 is the electron's charge radius. So the result is 44 femtometers. So in fact, it's a quite large value, and nuclei fit inside the magnetic monopole. And the same way we can calculate the mass. As you remember, the particle mass is inverse proportional to the Zitterbewegung radius. So this value that we have is 4.1 times alpha minus 3 larger than the electron's Zitterbewegung radius. And we take the inverse, and that's how much the particle is lighter than the electron. So the value we get is 48.4 milli electron volts. So it's a very, very light particle. Now, considering charge conservation, monopoles have to be created in pairs, a plus and minus monopole, to conserve total charge. So to create a pair of opposite charges, we will need then 96.8 milli electron volts. So if we calculate in the temperature scale, this corresponds to 1,100 kelvins approximately and 850 celsius. So that's quite interesting. I'm not sure what it exactly means, but maybe it's related to Parkhomov's ideas from yesterday, when he was thinking that in a hot LNR reactor, there is some particles created which catalyze nuclear reactions. So is it possible that above 850 Celsius, we are able to catalyze and create magnetic monopoles? It's an interesting question. And it somehow is in line with Parkhomov's ideas, but we don't know what exactly is the condition needed to create monopoles. Obviously, it cannot be a very simple process to create them, because we would see it all the time, right? 96 millielectron volts is such a low value that if it would be very ordinary process, we would have all the time monopoles flying around, but that's not the case. So there is some kind of condition for creating them, which we still don't understand.
You have only 3 minutes.
Okay, so I'm now going to the conclusion slide. So here is my conclusion slide. Magnetic monopoles are unstable elementary particles. In fact, in Mikhailov's group measured that once they stop shining light on their charged nanoparticles, they lost their magnetic charge in a fraction of a second. So the lifetime is much less than 1 second. Now, we succeeded to calculate from available experimental data the monopole's rest mass. It's a very light particle, 48 millielectron volts is approximately its mass. We must investigate further which are the conditions that lead to monopole pair production and the possible role of monopoles to catalyze Elianar reactions must be further investigated. So thank you for the attention. I hope this presentation was inspiring to investigate more about monopoles.
Thank you very much. Прошу вопросы задавать. Значит, первым у нас поднял руку Анатолий Климов. Прошу. Анатолий Климов.
Да, слышно меня, нет?
Да, да, слышно.
Андрес, I have a small question for you concerning concerning to the action of these strange particles named monopole to the low energy nuclear reaction. We know that there are many transmutation, there is transmutation of the chemical elements in the final products of the, our reactor. Do you think about how these strange particles helps or not help to this process of transmutation? What do you think about transmutation process?
Well, I think that it is probably involved somehow because there were some experiments where magnetic monopoles and transmutations were simultaneously detected. For example, Urotskoyev's experiments. But I wish I knew and understood the details. So honestly, I have no idea exactly how monopoles catalyze transmutations. I don't understand what happens when they interact with nucleus.
And according to your opinion, the monopole is only a secondary particles, not active particles in the low energy reactions.
I don't know. Unfortunately, I don't know. So I think all that we know is what is in these conclusion slides. And in addition, we know that transmutations and monopoles are simultaneously detected, but I don't know.
Mikhailov works is very interesting. Can you send for us, for Russian community, this work?
You mean this slide?
Yeah.
Yes, I will send by email this slide.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Так, второй вопрос. Владимир Чепелев, пожалуйста.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I have a question about the relationship of energy in electron volts and temperature. May you show the slide before previous? Yes, this one. I think this temperature is too low. As I understand, the temperature corresponds to one electron volt is about two.
Is that correct, Volod? Is that correct?
Yes.
It is correct.
And what's the reason?
96 milli electron volts, it corresponds to.
Milli, not million.
Yeah, no, milli.
Yeah, now it's clear.
Okay. Yeah, this is 0.1 electron volt.
I see.
Маленькая буква M. Так, следующий вопрос, Виктор Панчелюга.
Maybe interesting exist official publication of Fredericks in a Russian journal Engineering Physics number 6 of 2030, not only preprints.
You mean 2013?
13, yeah.
Yeah, but I think this new one is from 2019. So I think this is more complete because I think he made more measurements since then.